And welcome to the Daily News Simplified, the what, why and how of newspaper reading. Today, we'll be discussing the Delhi edition of the Hindu newspaper dated 3rd January 2019. The articles to be discussed today are reflected on your screen and the timestamping for the same has been provided in the description box below. So let's start. This news article appears on both page number 1 as well as on page number 10 and is talking about the central government's recommendation to set up a new panel to protect Assam's heritage as well as indigenous communities. From your UPSC syllabus, it will form a part of your GS paper 2 under the category of governance as well as polity. As per the news article, the Union Cabinet, chaired by the Prime Minister, has approved the setting up of a high-level committee for the implementation of Clause 6 of the Assam Accord of 1985. Before we discuss what the Clause 6 is, we first need to know few details about the Assam Accord. Now basically, starting from the year 1979 up to the year 1985, Assam witnessed a lot of political instability wherein the state government had collapsed as well as the new elections which were conducted by the government were totally boycotted. Further, there were a lot of ethnic violence based on linguistic and communal identities which killed lakhs and lakhs of people. And this violence and instability was basically over the issue of foreigners or illegal immigrants who had entered Assam, especially after the 1971 war. Thus, to end the Assam agitation, the Assam Accord was signed, which is nothing but a memorandum of settlement between the Government of India, the then Government of Assam, as well as the leaders of the Assam movement, which consisted of the All Assam Students Union as well as the All Assam Gana Sangram Parishad. You don't need to remember their full names. Just remember that the memorandum was signed between the Government of India as well as the leaders of the Assam movement. This Assam Accord, which was a memorandum of settlement, brought an end to the Assam agitation and also helped to douse the issue of illegal immigration. Basically, the leaders of these Assam movement were against granting of Indian citizenship to illegal migrants from Bangladesh who had entered Assam after the year of 1971. As per this accord, 1st January 1996 was selected as the base year for the purpose of detection as well as deletion of foreigners. So as per the accord, all those people who entered Assam prior to 1966 were not considered as illegal migrants and it was decided that they shall be regularized. That is, they would be granted Indian citizenship. The second case was of all those people who entered after 1st January 1996 up to 24th March 1971. So as per the accord, all of such people will be dealt according to the provisions of the Foreigners Act. Hence the name of all such people was deleted from the electoral rolls and these people were eligible for Indian citizenship only after they registered themselves as per the provisions of the Registration of the Foreigners Act. And further, even after registering, they had to live in the state of Assam for minimum 10 years, after the expiration of which they would be granted voting rights. So thus, people falling in the second category were not deported from the state, but in order to get citizenship and the voting rights, they had to register themselves and also had to stay in the state for 10 years. The third case was all those people who entered Assam after 25th March 1971. As per the accord, all these foreigners who came on or after 25th March 1971 were to be expelled and deported back. Further, to give actual effect to this memorandum of settlement, amendments were made to the Citizenship Act of 1955. Hence, accordingly, the Citizenship Act was amended in the year 1985 to insert a new section, that is Section 6A, into the Citizenship Act, which dealt with citizenship of persons covered under this Assam Accord. Now, if you have been following the news regularly, you would know that the Assam Accord and this Section 6A of the Citizenship Act is related to the larger issue of the NRC, that is the National Registered Citizen, as well as the issue of the Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2016. Now, due to paucity of time, we would not be covering these two topics, but if you wish to understand the full detailed context of Assam Accord and the NRC, you can refer to the DNS video of 1st August 2018. In that video, the Assam Accord as well as the issue of NRC has been covered in depth. Now, coming back to the main focus of this news, the news was talking that the Union Cabinet wants to set up a high-level committee to implement Clause 6 of the Assam Accord. Now, the Clause 6 of the Assam Accord provides for the constitutional, administrative as well as legislative safeguards to protect, preserve as well as promote the cultural, social, linguistic identity as well as heritage of Assam. Further, this high-level committee would also look into the possibility of reserving assembly seats for the indigenous communities of Assam so that they can take part in the state legislative elections. Thus, the committee will assess what all measures need to be taken so as to protect the Assamese culture, language, as well as other unique identity, and also to look into the possibility of reserving certain seats in the state assembly elections for the indigenous communities. This news appears on page number 13 and is talking about that manufacturing activities in India has slowed down in December as per the Purchasing Managers Index. So, as per the Purchasing Managers Index, the manufacturing activities in India, though they expanded, but have expanded at slower rate in the month of December because there was less increase or less growth as far as new orders and the total output was concerned. And this observation has been made by the Purchasing Managers Index. Now, as far as your syllabus is concerned, it will form a part of the Indian economy, and from your exam perspective, this trend of the manufacturing activity is not that important, but what is important is to know the details about the Purchasing Managers Index, which can be asked in your prelims. The Purchasing Managers Index has been covered comprehensively in the September edition of the Focus. Now, the Purchasing Managers Index data is published by a Japanese firm called Nikkei, but is compiled by a company called as the Market Economics. So please bear in mind that the Purchasing Managers Index is not published by any Indian body or institution, but is rather published by a Japanese firm called Nikkei. Now, as far as the source of information for the PMI is concerned, the parameters or the economic indicators to calculate this data are based on monthly surveys of the various private sector companies. Please remember that public sector units or public sector companies are excluded from this survey. Hence, under PMI, monthly survey of private sector companies are conducted, in which data is collected by talking and surveying almost 500 purchasing managers of such companies, which are working in different manufacturing sectors related to various fields. Hence, this survey is based on the perception which these purchasing managers have about the conditions in that related manufacturing sector. Hence, these purchasing managers, who are the respondents for the survey, report either better, same or worse conditions than the previous months. Lastly, you need to remember that the Purchasing Managers Index is compiled separately for the manufacturing sector as well as the service sector, but the manufacturing sector holds more importance. Now, from a prelims perspective, what can be of importance is the difference between the Purchasing Managers Index and the Index of Industrial Production, that is IIP. As discussed, the PMI is published by Nikkei, which is a Japanese firm, whereas the IIP is published by the Central Statistics Office, which is a governmental agency working under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Next, the PMI does not track the actual production, but is rather based, as we discussed earlier, on the perception of the purchasing managers in that manufacturing sector. But whereas IIP is concerned, the Index of Industrial Production tracks the actual production, that is the real output which has been produced by a manufacturing sector, is taken into consideration while compiling the IIP. Further, the PMI only covers 500 private sector companies, whereas IIP covers both the private as well as the public sector companies. The PMI covers both the manufacturing sector as well as the services sector, whereas IIP covers only the manufacturing sector and not the service sector. Now, since we know that under the PMI, the survey is only conducted for the private sector companies, hence the PMI is less comprehensive as it does not take into account the perception of the public sector companies. And on the other hand, since IIP covers both the private as well as the public sector, it is more comprehensive in nature. Lastly, very importantly, you should remember that the Purchasing Managers Index is not used by India for the calculation of GDP, whereas IIP is used to calculate the GDP, especially for the unorganized sector in our economy. Now that we know that PMI is not used to calculate GDP, the next logical question should be, for what is PMI then important? The answer to this lies in the timing of when this PMI is released. The PMI is usually released before the official data on the industrial output, manufacturing, or GDP growth becomes available in the country. To give you an idea, the PMI is released on 1st of every month, whereas the IIP is released on 12th of every month. So since PMI is released before the official data, it serves as a good leading indicator of the economic activity in our economy. Thus, with the help of PMI, we can already know what the trend of the manufacturing sector in our economy would be, whether it would grow, whether it would stay stagnant, or whether it would fall down. Hence, PMI becomes very important as far as projections of trends are concerned. Now, based on discussion, here is a prelims practice question relating to Purchasing Managers Index. Please pause the video and solve this. We will discuss the answer after 5 seconds. The first statement, it is published by the Central Statistics Office, is incorrect. As we have discussed, the PMI is published by the Japanese firm Nikkei. It is the IIP which is published by the Central Statistics Office. Second, it takes into consideration both the private as well as the public sector companies. This too is incorrect. It takes into consideration only the private sector companies and not the public sector companies. Third, it compiles data separately for the services sector. This is correct. PMI brings out data separately for the service sector as well as the manufacturing sector. Hence, the right answer is C, 3 only. Therefore, we come to an end of this discussion. Let's move on to our next article. The next news is a lead article taken from page number 8, in which the author is talking about the South Asian regional market for electricity trade. The article focuses on the guidelines released by the Union Ministry of Power for the export and import, that is the cross-border trade of electricity 2018. These guidelines for cross-border electricity trade will provide rules for the flow of electricity across the South Asian borders. Hence, these new electricity guidelines are a first step towards creating a South Asian regional market for electricity trade. From your UPSC syllabus, it will form a part of GS Paper 2 under the category of international relation, as well as it can also be asked under GS Paper 3 in the category of economic and infrastructure development. As far as the aspects of the guidelines are concerned, the first thing you should know is that these guidelines take forward the bilateral power trade agreements which India had individually signed with various countries like Bhutan in 2006, Bangladesh in 2010, as well as Nepal in 2014. Further, these guidelines are also the first step towards fulfillment of the objectives signed under the SAARC Framework Agreement for Energy Cooperation of 2014. So basically, India has bilaterally, that is one-on-one, signed energy trade agreement with certain countries. And in addition to bilateral trade agreements, India has also signed the SAARC Framework Agreement for Energy Cooperation. Hence, these guidelines will help India to fulfill its objectives and duty signed under both these bilateral trade agreements as well as the SAARC Framework Agreement. As far as the objectives of the guidelines are concerned, the first thing these guidelines want to achieve is that they want to facilitate export and import of electricity between India and its neighboring countries. That is the foremost aim of these guidelines, to build a conducive environment under which electricity can be exported and imported. Second, the guidelines want to evolve a dynamic and robust electricity infrastructure for the export and import of electricity. Thus, these guidelines envisage a robust electricity infrastructure under which the export and import of electricity across the borders would become possible as well as convenient. Third, these guidelines also want to promote transparency, consistency, and predictability in the regulatory mechanism as far as export and import of electricity is concerned. Therefore, its third objective is to create a transparent and accountable regulatory mechanism for such cross-border electricity trade. Fourth and finally, these guidelines want to enable a reliable grid operation and transmission of electricity for the import and export. What it means is that these guidelines are not just focusing on the infrastructure or the regulatory mechanism, but are also focusing on the practical grid operation and transmission of electricity across borders. Another very important thing to remember about these electricity guidelines is that these new guidelines for the first time will allow a tripartite trading in electricity. By tripartite trading, we mean that power would be generated in one country and then it would be routed over the territory of the second country so that finally a third country can consume that electricity. For example, the electricity is generated in Nepal, then that electricity would be routed over the territory of India so that it can be consumed by countries like Bangladesh and Myanmar. Having discussed the objectives of the guidelines, let us now look at the significance or the various benefit which India can achieve if it implements these cross-border electricity guidelines. The first significance will be that if India can lead in South Asian electricity trade, then this would also be a progressive step towards an increased South Asia cooperation and integration. Thus, this electricity trade between South Asian countries can serve as a vital stepping stone for a strengthened South Asian cooperation and integration, which hitherto has lacked in the South Asian region. Second, these guidelines are reflective of India's foreign policy, especially when it comes to the Gujral Doctrine. The main essence of the Gujral Doctrine was that since India is the largest country in the South Asia region, it should extend unilateral concessions to its other neighboring countries and should not ask for any kind of reciprocity. Hence, this cross-border electricity trade can provide a concession to India's neighbor, especially in the area of political and economic importance, thereby strengthening India's position in the South Asian region. Third, with the help of cross-border electricity, India can try to transition to a power grid based on renewable energy. This India can do by harnessing the hydropower reserves, especially from the Himalayas river system in the countries of Nepal and Bhutan. For long, Nepal and Bhutan have recognized that their economic prosperity is based on the sustainable use of the vast hydropower reserves that they carry, which is very much similar to the oil-based economic prosperity which has been now achieved by the Arab countries. Hence, these guidelines will not only help the countries of Nepal and Bhutan, but will also help India to transition into a renewable energy power grid. Having discussed the significance, let us now look at a few concerns or challenges which lie before India to implement its ambitious cross-border electricity trade agreement. The first concern arises from an increased Chinese investment and influence in the South Asian countries' energy sectors. Of late, China is making significant investment in various energy sectors of different South Asian countries. Therefore, very logically, the presence and great influence of China is one of the major challenges for India. Second, is that for this project to actually see the light of the day, there is the requirement to construct regional institutions which will absorb all the politics as well as manage the technicalities and the nitty-gritties of electricity trade. Because it's one thing to talk on paper that you would create and facilitate cross-border electricity, but it is another thing altogether to actually build institutions on a regional level which can manage these day-to-day technicalities of electricity trade across the borders of countries. Now, thirdly, it is very much understood that the administration of the regional grid will be managed by India because of its geographical centrality. That is to say that since India is located centrally as far as geography of the region is concerned, the regional grid and the regional institution would be managed by India. But with time, as the economic interdependency between these countries would increase, all these other South Asian nations will start to demand a joint as well as independent regional institutions to be built in their country or rather in their territory as well. Hence, over a period of time, there is apprehension that India's administrative monopoly in this electricity trade agreement would reduce or decrease with time. Last point is concerned with the location of resources. Now, the South Asian grid system would mainly be located within the purview of the BBIN, that is within the territories of Bangladesh, Bhutan, India and Nepal. Therefore, to achieve a larger South Asian integration, it is very important to integrate the energy deficient countries like Pakistan and Afghanistan, who naturally do not have those resources to generate electricity. Thus, if the South Asian grid has to act as a medium or a liaison for South Asian cooperation and integration, it is very important to bring together even the energy deficient countries like Pakistan and Afghanistan within the purview of the South Asian electricity trade. The next news is an article taken from page number 9 and is in respect of INS Arihant and India's nuclear capabilities. From your examination point of view, it will form a part of GS paper 3 in the category of security. Further, it can also be a part of GS paper 2 under the subcategory of international relations. In this article, the author is questioning the deterrence and survivability capability of INS Arihant with regards to fulfilling India's capability of a nuclear triad. A nuclear triad is basically a three-pronged military structure which consists of a land-launched nuclear missile-armed submarines, as well as strategic aircraft with nuclear bombs and missile. For India, land-based nuclear capability is provided by the Agni missiles, air-based nuclear capability is provided by the Sukhoi jets, in addition to any other aircraft which is capable of launching nuclear missiles. And finally, with the addition of INS Arihant, which provided India with a naval-based nuclear capability, India's nuclear triad is now complete. And in this article, the author is basically questioning the deterrence and survivability capability of this INS Arihant. Now, any nuclear arms capability is broadly judged on its ability to provide deterrence and survivability. In this background, the author is arguing about the deterrence and the survivability which is offered by INS Arihant. As far as deterrence is concerned, the author feels the requirement of INS Arihant arose because of a Cold War scenario that if at all a situation arises in which an enemy country launches a first nuclear strike and destroys India's all land-based and air-based nuclear capabilities, then in that situation, INS Arihant still could deliver a second strike for India. So basically what the author is saying is that even if India's land and air nuclear capabilities are compromised in an event of a first nuclear attack by another country, then also INS Arihant, which forms the naval part of a nuclear triad, can provide India with an opportunity as well as a capability to strike back on that enemy country. And it is due to this capability of INS Arihant to launch a return strike or a second strike on that enemy country that it ensures that every country who is conducting a first strike is deterred or demotivated to carry out a nuclear attack. This is for the reason that the attacking country would also know that India has INS Arihant and India too can strike back, and that same country would also suffer losses. So the theory of deterrence is basically based on the concept of mutually assured destruction as far as nuclear warfare is concerned. Second, the author says that in an event a country launches a nuclear strike on India and manages to destroy the land as well as air-based nuclear capability of India, then too, India will have the third leg in the form of INS Arihant, which it can use against the enemy to survive in that war. Therefore, what the author is saying is that INS Arihant will provide survivability to India as it can help India in second strike. Moving ahead, the author is now providing criticism or loopholes in the survivability and deterrence capability of INS Arihant. Firstly, the author says, if we were to imagine an event in which an enemy launches a nuclear strike on India, then it would automatically dilute the deterrence capability of INS Arihant. To simply put, what the author is saying is that if a country does attack India, then the idea of having a nuclear capable naval arm dilutes the concept of deterrence, because this nuclear capable naval arm was not able to stop the country from attacking India. Further, the author points out that it is very unlikely that in an event of nuclear attack, India will lose all its land and air-based nuclear weapon. Therefore, if India's air and land-based nuclear weapon continue to exist even after the first strike, then also the survivability aspect of having INS Arihant gets diluted. That is to say, if India still has its land and air-based nuclear weapon, then why would it need a naval nuclear weapon to survive? Thus, the author argues that the deterrence and survivability aspect of the nuclear security of India does not become better or stronger by having INS Arihant in its nuclear triad. Secondly, the author also points to the fact that Pakistan, who is India's immediate neighbor, does not have the capability to completely destroy India's land and air-based nuclear capabilities. Hence, from the point of view of nuclear security from Pakistan, having INS Arihant does not add up to our security, because firstly, Pakistan itself does not have a naval leg of the nuclear triad, and secondly, even the nuclear capability which Pakistan possesses is not enough to completely destroy India's nuclear weapons. Moving ahead, in the context of China, author simply points out and say that INS Arihant does not have the range to deliver nuclear weapons over China. Hence, INS Arihant is absolutely futile when it comes to attaining nuclear protection from China. Further, the author also feels that China is already way far ahead of India in many respects, as it has more number of warheads and also have more number of nuclear-powered submarines. Hence, in an event of a nuclear attack from China, India will not be able to survive as far as the naval defense is concerned. Lastly, with respect to China, the author says that both India and China have very localized territorial dispute, and both the countries are very wise and smart to not get involved in an all-out war involving nuclear weapons. Hence, in conclusion, the author feels that INS Arihant will not be able to provide the survivability and deterrence capability to India, especially when it comes to dealing with Pakistan and China. The next news has been taken from page number 5 and is talking about how exotic invasive tree species have started to eat up Western Ghats Shola grasslands. A new study has highlighted the problem of exotic invasive species in the Shola grasslands of the Western Ghats. As per the study, almost 40% of the native species from these Shola grasslands in the Western Ghats have now disappeared due to the invasion by the exotic tree species. As far as the Sholas are concerned, these Shola are basically a mix of montane tropical forest as well as grasslands, which are found in the southern part of the Western Ghats, especially in the high altitude regions. Now the question arises how these exotic invasive species first entered these grasslands. Now almost 50 years back, the Tamil Nadu Forest Department began planting such exotic trees in the Shola grasslands in order to meet the demand for firewood, leather, as well as wood pulp. Over the period of time, thousands of hectares of such grasslands have now been converted into plantations. Though these plantations were stopped by the mid-1990s, yet these non-native trees, that is the exotic trees, continue to spread and invade the grasslands. Now the key finding of this study shows that these exotic non-native trees has basically invaded the grasslands but have not been successful in invading the Shola forest patches. Hence, according to the study, about 60% of the Shola grassland has now changed, with almost 40% of the native grassland species disappearing from that region. Further, 50% loss in Shola grasslands is reported from the Nilgiri, Palani and Annamalai hill regions, which are one of the most prominent regions having the Shola landscape. Next, which are the exotic species which have invaded these grasslands? There are basically three species: wattle, which is a form of acacia, eucalyptus, as well as pine. Wattle is the most dominant invasive tree species in that area and was introduced for the purpose of firewood. Eucalyptus and pine were introduced mainly to satisfy the demand for the wood pulp in that region. With regard to what steps should be taken in order to get rid of the exotic invasive tree species, the first step to be taken is to cut all these exotic trees from these areas, and then eventually the grasslands will return back themselves. But since the return of natural grassland takes a very long time, cutting down of invasive species might not be enough. Therefore, what the government should do is that they should try and protect the remaining grasslands so as to save them from the invasion of such exotic species. And secondly, the government should also try to reduce the plantations in such areas so that the natural grasslands get the time as well as the area to grow back. Based on discussion, here is a prelims practice question. Please pause the video and solve it. We will discuss the answer after 5 seconds. The question reads, with respect to Shola forest, which of the following statements are correct? First, they are found in the southern part of the Eastern Ghats. This is wrong. They are found in the southern parts of the Western Ghats. Second, Nilgiri and Annamalai hills are examples of region where they are found. This statement is right. Hence, the right answer becomes B, 2 only. With this, let's move on to our next article. The next news has been taken from page number 1 and is with respect to the introduction of a new bill in the Lok Sabha which talks about voluntary use of Aadhaar card. Now, after the Supreme Court's judgment on the voluntary use of Aadhaar card for opening new bank accounts or buying a new SIM card for the mobile phones, the central government has now introduced a bill in the Lok Sabha to carry out the necessary amendment. The Aadhaar and Other Law Amendment Bill of 2018 aims to amend the Telegraph Act as well as the Prevention of Money Laundering Act so as to enable voluntary sharing of the 12-digit identification number of the Aadhaar for obtaining new mobile phone or opening bank accounts. The Supreme Court, while listening to the Aadhaar case, had struck down the Section 57 of the Aadhaar Act as unconstitutional because it called for the ceding of the biometric ID, that is the Aadhaar, and made it mandatory for buying a SIM card or opening a bank account. So earlier, as per Section 57 of the Aadhaar Act, it was compulsory and mandatory for the people to provide their biometric Aadhaar card in order to buy a new SIM card or open a new bank account. But the Supreme Court held this section to be unconstitutional because it enabled or allowed a body corporate to use the personal biometric information of an individual through the way of Aadhaar for establishing an individual's identity. Due to the paucity of time, we cannot go into the entire detail of this Supreme Court judgment. But if you wish to know the details about this judgment, you can refer to the DNS dated 27 September 2018, where the entire Aadhaar judgment has been covered very comprehensively. With this, let's move on to our next article. This next article has been taken from page number 18 and is in the reference to the Climate Change Performance Index of 2019. Let us know a few details about this Climate Change Performance Index. This index is published annually by the German Watch and the Climate Action Network Europe. The CCPI is basically a tool designed to bring enhanced transparency, especially in the area of international climate politics. The CCPI aims to put political and social pressure on all those countries that have until now failed to take proper action on climate protection and climate change policy. Now, the CCPI evaluates the country on the basis of 14 indicators spread over 4 categories. The 4 main categories are greenhouse gas emissions, expansion and use of renewable energy, energy efficiency and use, as well as policies by the government to cater to climate change. Finally, India has achieved a high score on these rankings and has been ranked 11 out of 58 countries who are responsible for almost 90% of carbon dioxide emissions in the world. The Climate Change Performance Index can be very important from the perspective of your UPSC, especially in the area of environment and ecology. With this, let's move on to our next article. The next article is an editorial taken from page number 8 and is talking about the reduction in the tax collection from the GST. Now, the author says, according to the 2018 budget estimates, the monthly target of GST collection should have been 1,06,000 crores. But from the months of April to December, the average collection of GST has only been 97,000 crores. Therefore now, to achieve the annual target, on an average, GST collections would have to reach 1,35,000 crores in the next 3 months. Hence, the author is pointing out that even in the coming time, the GST collection will reduce and therefore, it may not be able to meet the requirement of the government as per the target which has been set. The author then gives us certain reasons why GST collection would be less in the coming time. Firstly, the GST Council very recently has reduced the tax rate for almost 20 goods, and this is likely to put an additional pressure on the GST revenue. Secondly, there has been a low growth in the direct tax collection, which would again cause a burn in the government's revenue. Thirdly, the author also feels that the proceeds from the disinvestments will not be adequate to fill in the gap which has now been created due to reduced GST collection from the period of April to December. Finally, the author also says that there has been no special increase in the tax collection during the recent Diwali festive season, because usually during the festivals, there is higher consumption of goods and services by the people, which leads to increase in tax collection. But this trend has not been seen during this Diwali festive season. Next, the author talks about certain impact which the slow collection of GST will have. Firstly, the center has already exceeded its fiscal deficit target of 3.3%. Hence, it is very obvious that the center will exceed the fiscal deficit target when this financial year comes to an end. Second, the center is bound to compensate the states for the revenue shortfall for the first 5 years of the GST regime. And this is likely to put an additional pressure on the center's finances, making it difficult to achieve the fiscal deficit target. Hence, the dip in the collection of the GST poses great challenges for the center, especially in the coming months. Finally, in conclusion, the author says that looking at the present trend, that is especially the trend when people did not consume more during the festive season, the author feels that if the consumers do not spend money or consume goods, then the consumption-led investment in our country will not increase. And this would in turn make it difficult for the government to achieve the 8% GDP growth rate. With this, we come to an end of this discussion. Let's move on to our next article. The next news is a snippet taken from page number 18 in the In Brief section. It is talking about the phenomenon of murmuration, which was put on by the starling birds. This topic is important from the context of your environmental portion. Now, murmuration is a phenomena in which hundreds of birds, especially the starling birds, fly in a swooping and an intricately coordinated pattern throughout the sky, which looks like a spectacular aerial dance display. Here is a picture of how murmuration looks. Now about the starlings. Starlings are basically small birds native of Russia and Eastern Europe who migrate to Middle East during the winters. As far as the IUCN status of starlings are concerned, it is least concerned. Based on a discussion, here is a prelims practice question. Please pause the video and solve it. We will discuss the answer after 5 seconds. The question reads, with reference to the bird starling, which of the statements are correct? First, their IUCN status is vulnerable. This is incorrect. Their IUCN status is of least concern. Second, they are known for the phenomena of murmuration. This is absolutely right. Hence, the right answer is B, 2 only. With this, we come to an end for today's discussion. Let's move on to the question of the day.